and welcome to the 51st episode of Growing Up Geek, the weekly podcast for geek entertainment and nostalgia. My name is Brad, and I am joined by my brother Rob.
Hello, buddy boy.
Hey, what's getting up, man?
My radio chops back.
Yeah, you've been out for a little while.
Yeah, I'm. Things are going well. Actually, it just occurred to me something that I don't know if I've shared yet on the show, is that I went to the East Coast Video Game Expo recently.
Oh, geez. No, you didn't share this.
Yeah, I guess it's...
I don't even know about this.
Yeah, exactly. It's one of the first major things on the East Coast. It's done by, like, videogames.net or something like that.
Oh, okay.
I'm trying to remember, but everybody involved. I think the guy from E3 is actually involved with this, and
okay.
The turnout was big enough this year. It spanned 3 days, and
oh, wow.
It's actually starting to get some industry recognition, so the VGXPO or whatever.
yeah, they'll have to work on the name a little bit.
VGXPO or just VGX is what I think
so
it's called. Yeah.
You attended that. Did you see any new games or anything? Are they sneak previewing things? Or?
Nah, I mean, it was really just kind of like a place for, you know, guys to get together and share their love for video games. And there were a few keynotes. I attended one that just was the state of video games, and it was nothing like what E3 has or something, where you have like laser light shows in the PowerPoint presentation by Sony.
Right.
It was just, yeah, people talking. Most of them were from the legal side, because there's a lot of that in this area. On the East Coast, you have like Washington, D.C., and a lot of lobbyists who help support the video game industry. So we got to hear from them.
Yeah, what is the state of video games?
It's actually pretty good. They were saying, like, in the case of the recession, people can turn to video games more willingly because they get more out of their entertainment dollar.
More bang for their buck, yeah.
Exactly. And even though a game is still, like, $60 these days, and I hope that price gets cut back a little, but
yeah.
Compared to taking somebody out to a two-hour movie, like taking your family out, you're going to get more out of buying, like, a game like Fallout 3, which will last you a good 40 hours or so.
Right, sure.
One point of interest that I learned there was that basically used video games hurt the market.
Yeah.
And remember this, boys and girls, they were talking about piracy, and that transitioned into used video game sales, because the impact is almost the same. The only difference is that there's a legal loophole, you know, in the case of used video games, but it's still let me sell you this game. You pay me to get somebody else's product.
Yeah, and it's not illegal, like you said, but you know, obviously it does hurt companies somewhat. And as much as I know that, and I'm such a supporter of buying things legally and everything, and I know that it hurts the company, I still I have to do it sometimes, because it saves money. You know, I mean, it's a good way to get a cheap game that you didn't want to. I mean, being $60, that's a little ridiculous. Everybody kind of has grunted endlessly about this, but you know, it's too much money sometimes, especially
part
the
of,
shortness of some of these games.
Yeah, which is why this isn't just, you know, the problem of the people who are pirating and selling used games. This is something that the video game industry needs to be nimble and start bringing the prices down of their games sooner and more substantially, so that people can actually, you know, chip in. I mean, obviously you have platinum hits and things like that, but that was interesting. And
I'm also interested in rental systems, you know, as a way of saving money. I've been renting so many games lately.
Yeah.
And this Christmas season, just by turning my philosophy from buying to renting, I played so many more games, and I beat most of the ones that I rented within the 5-day span. So, you know, after renting and beating in 5 days, you're kind of like, boy, that was a good idea, you know, instead of $60 kerplunk, and then you're left, you know, a week later beating it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, well, that sounds like a cool conference, man.
It was. It definitely was. And I got to say, because this is the part where it's really my life story, is I got to meet with composers for video games. And
very cool.
We went out to a sports bar, and we hung out. We exchanged information. And
dude, it's your dream.
I know. I'm finally making some big strides in getting into the industry. And if anybody out there, I handed my card and I put the podcast on there.
Oh, cool.
it was nice meeting you guys at the expo, and I look forward to working with you guys.
Sounds awesome. So why don't we turn from there to the world of geek news?
Woohoo!
Every week we like to read lots of geeky news stories and bring you our favorite. Rob, what was your favorite of the week?
Yeah, my favorite story of the week is that there is a Chronicles of Riddick game coming out, basically a new Chronicles of Riddick game.
Right.
Right. Now, I mean, it's complicated.
I didn't sound very excited, but no, that is a cool...
The sarcastic response from...
And against all odds, that game was good. Like, movie games are barely ever good. Chronicles of Riddick was actually good.
Yes. It served its purpose. It made me go see that movie despite how bad that movie was. You know? Now, let me explain why this is complicated, because this is actually... build as a remake of Chronicles of Riddick, Escape from Butcher Bay, which was an amazing Xbox game, probably one of the best-looking Xbox games.
It was,
And it actually coined the term first-person stabber, because it didn't rely on guns. It was dirty prison combat, and you shanked people.
Yeah, it reminded me of Condemned a little bit, probably, like an early Condemned.
Right, and it did it all right, and I actually think those two are related development-wise.
Okay.
But
shanking.
The remake, it was announced briefly a while back.
Right.
Because apparently they used so many tricks to get that thing to look the way it did on Xbox that they couldn't very well emulate it on the 360, so they were like, oh, I guess we'll have to make a remake.
Right.
But... that kind of went away, and then just recently at an Atari convention, they announced that the game was still being made, and beyond that, that it's going to include something called the Assault on Dark Athena, which is basically like Episode 2 of Half-Life.
Escape from Butcher Bay, Episode 2.
Essentially, because it picks up right where the Escape from Butcher Bay left off.
Yeah, now I've been hearing that this is a sequel. Are you saying this is the remake and the sequel included in one package?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
One box.
Because I never played the first game. I just sort of saw it over your shoulder.
Yeah, and it's looking good. You know, Vin Diesel still looks Vin Diesel-y.
Diesel-esque.
And there'll be new mechanics, because I think it's going to be taking place on a ship in outer space. So they'll be dealing a lot with kind of like the vacuum of space.
That's cool.
And so I'm excited, because I enjoyed the first game very much, and it's kind of one of those secret joys that I had, because nobody else played that game, and I got to play it. And I like the possibility that other people may be finally getting a chance to play this game and give it its just desserts.
Yeah, I think that's a theme that will come back later in the show when we talk about our main topic.
Right.
But it's always great whenever something comes back like that. And you can share it with people and say, oh, this was a great thing you missed. You know, like Psychonauts, I got to play that. Of course, I bought it used. Sorry for hurting the game industry. But no, I love, you know, I'm so glad that I didn't miss that, you know.
Yeah.
What is the Dark Athena? I guess you say it's a ship. Do we know any more details about it besides that?
Well, that's what it seems to be. I actually haven't researched much because I don't want to spoil too much.
Sure,
But it seems to be what you're escaping from Butcher Bay on, you know.
Oh, I
and
get
so
it.
You kind of have to go through the trouble of procuring this vessel.
So you did escape from Butcher Bay, I guess, in Escape from Butcher
Bay?
Well,
yeah, it's one thing to be assumed that there is an escape that happens.
and the title gives it away.
All right. And also, spoilers. This supposedly will lead into Pitch Black.
Now, will this be a first-person stabber or third-person stabber?
First-person stabber. Yeah, it's the same game, but it's the second whole campaign, like 10 to 12-hour thing that you play after you get through the whole Butcher Bay scenario.
Pretty cool. So you're jazzed about that, obviously.
Very jazzed.
And to not have to coat the entire show in video games, I'll share my news story now, which is movie-related.
Ah.
Empire Magazine has released their list of the 100 greatest movie characters of all time.
Oh, my.
So this is something geeks care about, you know, top 10 lists, top 100 lists. You know, if you visit dig.com, it's like 90% top 10 lists, you know?
Right.
Obviously, we love that stuff. It's shameless, but we love it, you know? And, of course, people only really care about who won, but I'll give the top 10.
Okay.
So theoretically, each character on this list should be better than the last, right?
Theoretically.
See if you agree with this. So we start with Vito Corleone from The Godfather.
That's
Marlon Brando's character.
Great character.
Better than him is number 9, Ellen Ripley from the Alien Quadrology.
I agree.
Okay. Better than Ellen Ripley, Captain Jack Sparrow.
Oh.
From Pirates of the
Caribbean.
Well,
you know what? Really, you can have aliens without Ripley because the monster is still so amazing. Uh-huh. But you can't have Pirates of the Caribbean without Jack Sparrow. So as a character who carries an entire franchise on his back, mm-hmm. I would say maybe, yeah, I can get behind that.
Okay. I think that movie series tanks dramatically in the second episode. Right. And by the third, I was just like, I'm watching a guy walk down exploding stairs, and I'm like, who the heck is this guy?
Right.
You know, like, there's amazing visuals, and I'm like, who are any of these people? Explain the plot of that movie to me. I dare you. But, okay, Captain Jack Sparrow. That's a what to me, but all right, you see the logic. So we're going forward here. Better than him, the dude from The Big Lebowski.
No. That's not better than Marlon Brando.
now, I would... Yeah, you know what? Now you put it that way, it is kind of funny. I'm sure Matt would agree with this one, because I know Matt's a huge fan. He's got the shirt and everything.
He's, you know what, he deserves a spot in the top 10,
okay.
Probably, but I can't say for sure that his placement is ranking correctly.
I love that they list a greatest moment for each character, and his greatest moment was listed as paying for a milk carton with a check.
Yes.
You know, which he does at the beginning. And that does endear that character to me, I gotta say. That's a great intro. Never been a huge Lebowski guy, but Matt loves that, so I could see a lot of people. Do you think this list is written by younger people? Tell me when we get through with it. I don't know.
Okay.
Number six, better than the dude, Indiana Jones.
All right. I guess, once again, a character that carries a franchise. Harrison Ford's probably most memorable role.
Yeah, but I mean, you would say that's better, right? So we are increasing.
Yeah, that's working. That's working.
Okay, so that's working. So better than Indiana Jones, Hannibal Lecter. Silence of the Lambs, Anthony Hopkins.
You know what? Yes.
Yeah, I kind of agree with that one, too. It's like, as awesome as... I'm going to contradict myself here. The Silence of the Lambs series, Lord knows, it's like a quadrilogy of its own now. That tanks dramatically, and yet I think that character is so good, I may just give it to him. I may think they have something there.
I feel like they needed to throw in somebody who was a suspense icon, you know, like horror. Probably one of the most frightening individuals without even moving, you know, just from the sense of his logic and what he says.
Yeah, it's like he's almost not a villain or a hero necessarily. You know what I mean? Like, he sort of walks that very fascinating line. I think that's why we love to watch him. But okay, so better than Hannibal Lecter, and this is an easy one, Han Solo.
Yes.
Star Wars trilogy, and I love that their favorite moment for him was Han shoots first, Han shoots first. They just endlessly typed that. And it's like, yeah, all of the geeks know. They even sell a shirt that says Han shot first.
Yeah.
Oh, God. It makes no sense. It was great that he shot him under the table. Okay, sorry. I'm done now. I'll take
I've
my
been
medicine.
Looking forward to the Solo. Yes, I bet you have. Blam. Perfect moment.
Yeah.
Perfect moment.
Unlatches the gun from beneath the table.
I once saw a flash animation that kind of went through the entire movie like in a minute.
Yeah.
But it took particularly care of that moment where you see Greedo sitting down. And rather than the conversation being, you owe Jabba money and stuff like that, the conversation was more like this. I've come here and I'm pointing a weapon at you. Clearly you would be justified if you killed me because I'm clearly intending on killing you.
Right.
I don't even have to fire my weapon in order for you to know that I need to kill you. So you'd be completely justified in killing me in whatever manner you wish to.
That's great. Yeah, because that was Lucas's problem, was supposedly, oh, Han wouldn't do that. No, Han would do that. Okay, I've come to the realization we know more about Star Wars than George Lucas at this point.
Yeah, because how many times a week does the average Star Wars fan watch Star Wars?
And
how many times a year does George Lucas watch Star Wars?
Well, that's true. You
know? He's sometimes if it's on television, I'll catch it.
I bet he's sick of it by now. But moving on, we got number two. Okay, now this is controversial. I'm sorry, number three. Better than Han Solo, the Joker from The Dark Knight.
You know, like, I love that character. And
me too.
I really feel like he deserves a place.
This is where it gets tough. Like, this is the part of the list where it's going to get real contentious, because it's like, okay, now you're talking trash. I mean, that's a great character, but is he better than Han Solo? Come on.
That's tough. That's really
tough. I mean,
really
Han Solo, arguably great in all three movies.
Yeah.
Some people say he sort of gets weird by the third one, a little more silly, I guess. But you know what? Heath Ledger carries that movie. He makes it interesting.
Yeah.
He makes me want to watch another movie with him. But I think they got that wrong. I'm sorry. And it's, I know it's opinion, but it's like, I'm going to have to disagree with that.
Maybe. I really like him being on that list, though.
Oh, it's amazing. Yeah. And we've got Hannibal Lecter down there on number five. Heath Ledger better than Anthony Hopkins? What do you think?
I think that's the case. I do think that's true.
This generation's Hannibal Lecter, maybe.
Yeah.
Number two, Darth Vader. Darth freaking Vader. I mean, how can we really deny it? But of course, the fact that Darth Vader's number two means he's not number one.
Right.
And so the greatest film character of all time is about to be revealed.
I am ready for it.
Tyler Durden. It just sounds funny to say.
What?
Like, his name just sounded stupider than I normally thought. I mean, Fight Club, main character. And his finest moment listed was when he gives the speech about the rules of Fight Club.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know.
No, that's wrong. It needs to be changed. It needs to be changed now.
So this is the part where I thought maybe it's a younger audience. Like that
maybe it's
list.
Like a bunch of emo kids.
It could be, but
they freaking love Fight Club. They put it in every single one of their music videos. It's just, let's make a music video. What's the theme going to be? I know. Let's do Fight Club remade, but instead, I'm all the characters. All right, great idea. Film it.
I don't know. I think Fight Club is definitely one of the better movies of this generation. Like,
it's a fantastic movie. I'm not saying anything wrong against that, but honestly, Tyler Durden, he's not. No. I don't even know if I put him on the top 10. Like, number one?
Yeah, it's weird.
Granted, he makes that movie amazing, but, you know, Edward Norton has just as much blood and sweat poured into that movie.
Right.
And
he gets the shaft.
As a character, I don't want to interact with Tyler Durden. I don't want to meet Tyler Durden.
Or be Tyler
Durden. I don't
want to
be Tyler Durden for Halloween. You know, like,
that's a weird one. I want to see a kid show up at my door as that.
All he has to do is get a black eye and take his shirt off, you know, like, then, oh, you're Tyler Durden. Great job.
Yeah.
He has none of the kind of likability or appeal. He's awesome in the movie, but no.
He wouldn't even be above Ellen Ripley, in my opinion, on this list.
No, he wouldn't.
Yeah, so I don't know. Weird ending, twist ending, you might say.
Right.
Empire Magazine did that list, so you can blame them. Email us if you disagree with our take on it. Mail at growing-up-geek.com. And so now, having that darkness out of the way, let's move forward to our main topic of discussion, something that will be probably the longest title we have ever covered on this show, Super Street Fighter II Turbo HD Remix. That is long. So, hey, Street Fighter is definitely a game we grew up with. Capcom has enlisted Udon Comics to redraw the graphics. We'll get to the changes, but first, what do you love about Street Fighter?
Man, that moment of seeing it in the arcade and just realizing that I could have one-on-one combat with another person. It was so simple, but so genius. And then Fireballs makes Street Fighter, Street Fighter. You know, you can have Mortal Kombat, you can have Dead or Alive or Tekken, but Fireballs.
Literally. I know you remember, but we actually saw Fighting Street or Street Fighter 1 or whatever it was called with the giant buttons that you would pound. You know, people now talk about, oh, pressure-sensitive drum pads on Guitar Hero. No, this is 1980X, and they had these giant pressure-sensitive pads. The harder you punch them, the harder your character punches. And that's tough. That means you have to fight the machine, basically.
Yeah, those pads were always broken, I'm glad that they replaced it with the six buttons, which were just like, you know, light, medium, and hard, instead of just hitting it lightly, hitting it hard, and even harder.
Yeah, but
I mean, it was a novel idea, but it didn't work.
I gotta say, like, Street Fighter, just in general, the definition of a classic, which is you have an old game that is still just as fun as it was then. You know, this is 25 years later or whatever, and this is some of, like, the palm sweatiest, most exciting yelling type experiences that I still have when I play games. I'm not referring to the new one. We'll get to the new one, the changes they made. But, you know, especially when you get down to that fight where you have one hit left.
Yes.
You know?
And you're just both jumping around, like, trying.
Yeah,
and you're
like,
both like
idiots.
Ah!
Yeah, I'm almost like, I have, like, an out-of-body experience where I'm watching the fight, and I'm like, who's going to win? And then I'm like, oh, shoot, I got to do something.
Yeah.
To me, like, a great Street Fighter match is like a game of chess. Strategy, a classic, totally a classic. And so here Capcom has chosen to remix Street Fighter. My question to you, did Capcom ruin this, or how is the remix?
I'm going to say that they hit it out of the park. Anybody would have settled for them merely skinning this new HD graphics over the old game. Mm-hmm. You know, they would have said, that's good enough, you know. But what's amazing about this game isn't just the HD part, it's the remix part. Mm-hmm. They meticulously went through this game, and every minute strategy or move, they retuned it to try and just rebalance this whole game, make it more fun and more natural to play, you know?
Yeah, there are moves now that can be pulled off using the 4-button configuration rather than the 3-button. You can select the moves list from the menu. There's a lot of gameplay things.
Yeah, Ryu's fake fireball.
Yeah, have you pulled that off? I've been reading about that. I guess I'm not good enough to...
You know, it's basically a fireball, but you use a light kick instead of punch.
And it, like, fakes the animation.
Right. You know, and there have always been kind of these glitches that have occurred while people were playing the game, but it's good to see them acknowledging them. You know, like Ryu's red fireball as being an official move. And also something that I like is that they've cut out a lot of the bullcrap with these moves and how you execute them.
Yeah.
You know, we all know the fireball motion, down, down, forward, forward, punch, right?
Right.
But they used to have these ones that were like down, down, forward, forward, up, forward, punch, you know? And really, it shouldn't come down to you trying to pull off a move.
Yeah.
It should be down to you doing it because strategically that's the best thing to do right now.
Yeah.
They've improved the time frame in which you can do them and pull off combos.
It feels a little smoother.
Yeah, it's more accessible in a way.
Yeah, how are you dealing with the controls? Like, the Xbox has a notoriously bad D-pad. How are you dealing with that? Are you using the stick?
No, I'm using the D-pad.
Okay, and how's that working for you?
It works fine. It seems to, like, start off okay, but then as the fight rages on, it starts to, like, my thumb gets tired with some of these moves. Mm-hmm. But, no, it's not bad. It's not like the N64 D-pad, which grates your thumb into shredded cheese, you know?
Yeah.
This is a good D-pad for fighting games, but...
The Dreamcast D-pad was like a foot high.
Right. Know? For the more hardcore, there, I believe, are Street Fighter pads like out there with the 6-button
arcade
configuration.
Sticks, yeah.
There's arcade sticks. There's all sorts of ways to play this game, and it's worth that kind of attention, you know?
I've been using the joystick, and it's sort of like a revelation like snapped in my mind where I was like, you know what? An arcade joystick is similar to an analog joystick. I'll just try it like that. And actually, I've been having pretty good success with it, so I'd encourage you to check that out. The graphics for me are just so nice. It's not immediately noticeable how good they are until you switch on the old character animations, which you can do.
Yeah.
And especially like Saget, like Bob Saget, I guess.
Right.
No, Saget is like especially built in this and like beefy like he was in Alpha. And then you switch to the original and it's like a skinny like cancer patient kind of. So I'm really digging that. And actually, the fact that some of the characters look better has encouraged me to try them. You know, like I there were some characters that just looked too goofy for me before. But like Blanca, I beat the game as Blanca. Because
nice.
I just think he looks cool in this one. Like, he's really, you know, pumped up and, like, grizzly like I expect him to be. More like the art on the box, you know?
Yeah, even Dalsim looks ripped for a guy who's, you know, like, apparently on hunger strikes and stuff.
Yeah.
He's got, like, all sorts of muscles going on. And
is it Dalsim or Dalzim? There's, like, that whole...
You know what? Nobody knows how to pronounce anybody's name in this game. Like, I'm sure that we're going to get letters like, it's Ryu, not Ryu.
Right.
And other people are like, it's Ryu, it's Ru.
The difficulty... Guilty of playing Japanese games as an American kid. But anyway, I just want to say, like, I beat it as Blanca, and I had forgotten, like, his whole story. Like, he was, like, dropped out of a plane as a baby into the jungles of Brazil and stuff. And I have no confidence in the Chun-Li movie, but I think a real deal movie could be made with some of these whacked out stories.
Right.
So, loving the graphics. It's a little bit more westernized looks than full anime.
Yeah.
But it's so crisp, especially the backgrounds. I'm loving these huge HD backgrounds, you know?
Right.
And very nice. So what's your favorite character, best character?
Well, oh, man. I mean, I've always had a soft spot for Vega, but I think that's just because of how cool he looks. He still is kind of like a wonky character to play as in a bizarre choice. Right now, the guy who I'm getting the most mileage out of is actually Fei Long.
I saw that. Yeah, you were on the path to Phalanx. It said on your avatar.
Oh, really? I didn't know it would tell you that. Cool.
Yeah, it tells you. Some people are weirded out by this, but it tells you what level your friends are on if you roll over them on the Xbox thing. And it'll say, like, Guitar Hero, and it says, like, the song.
All the more reason that nobody's ever going to buy Rumble Roses and, like, sign online. People will be like, well, apparently he's in the photo session area.
Staring at
lot.
It. Yeah. So you're playing Phalanx. I saw that.
Right.
Did you beat it with Phalanx?
No, I haven't beaten it with him. I beat it with Ryu and got his ending. But Phalanx, I tried out the training mode with him, which is one reason why I'm more confident playing as him.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Because this training mode is pretty nice. It's kind of what... Excuse me. It's kind of what you always would do. You just get two players set up, and then you'd have one guy just stand there while you beat on him.
Yeah.
And you can enable the hitboxes to be visible.
I saw that
on
the
characters.
And that's the big thing that they paid close attention to is all of the hits are exactly the same as they were before. It's just the skin is different, you know?
Right.
So, yeah, you can study that stuff.
The reason why that ties into Street Fighter IV is because Street Fighter IV, they've actually are using two-dimensional hitboxes.
No, they said it made it feel so much better after the 2D hitboxes.
Yeah.
So you're going through as Phalanx. I'm actually, I've always been a DJ man, and I hear people denigrate DJ all the time, you know? But I just love his moves. I think I was showing Amber, I'm like, these are his four moves. They're all charging. Every single one of them, I think, looks cool. And I don't know why, but the first time he shaked his maracas, he shook his maracas.
Yeah.
I remember when we were playing, when we were kids, we would go, Master of Time and Space. It just sticks out in my mind. Like, so now every time I beat the fight, I go, Master of Time and Space. It makes no sense. I don't know where we got that from. But so bottom line, advice to people, is this worth $15 / 1,200 space bucks? Microsoft points.
This is probably one of the best purchases I think you can make on Xbox Live Arcade. I mean, honestly, if you don't have a decent fighting game in your collection, then you just aren't a very social human being.
we should say we didn't get to try the online, speaking of social, but we hear that it is great.
We've heard good things.
Yeah. It's working good. I can't wait to fight you online. That sounded weird.
No, it's perfectly legit these days.
I actually told Amber that I wasn't a very good Street Fighter, and she said, so you are a Street Fighter, like, of any kind? You know, because I was like, there's people who are really good Street Fighters. I guess that might not be the term, but I will see you on the streets at some point, the virtual streets.
Exactly.
So worth $15, you're saying?
Absolutely. And if anything, as a precursor to get ready for Street Fighter 4, I mean, that's the only thing against this game is that maybe you'd want to hold out for Street Fighter 4. But then again, this is Street Fighter 2, and what's awesome is that if you have any problem with how this game plays, you can go through and tweak the crap out of this game.
I've heard that, y'all, the switches and stuff.
Yeah, you can go through and be like, is it possible to do a one-frame
like
recovery after this, or is it... Does Doll Sim's teleport move cause fireballs if every 300% of the time? You know,
it's I think I feel how a Watchmen fan must feel like right now with looking at something that I love that is old being updated to look cool enough to matter to a new generation. You know,
right?
And it's like they did such a respectful job with this and Bionic Commando. Capcom is just like nailing their remakes, so that it's like, yeah, this is an old game. People, you know, might be put off by the graphics, but let's update that so that you can get the great classic gameplay. I'm sure Watchmen fans are hoping the same thing happens with their movie.
Yeah.
But I just think they did a bang-up job. Last question for you. What is another classic game, now that these two have been handled so well, that you think deserves this kind of treatment?
Man. All right. I know there's got to be something
here. I'll tell you mine.
Okay.
I'll tell you mine. Final Fantasy VII.
True.
Final Fantasy VII is a kick-butt RPG, and I know a girl at work whose favorite is Final Fantasy X. She went back to VII. She was unable to really get into it because of how it looks now. But, man, that's such a good game. I would love them to do it. And I know they're rumoring it, so I'm not going out too far on a limb here.
I hope that really happens. For me, you know what? All right. I'm going to do it.
Do it. Do it.
King's Quest.
Wow, fascinating choice. Adventure games are just...
Right. Adventure games are just like, where are you? And
I know.
It's something that I want people to appreciate, and I want them to get into, but it's going to be hard because nobody wants to play a game where you're not sure what to do next.
Yeah.
But that was the appeal, yeah.
I know. We're running out of time, but I'll throw three things real quick in your face, adventure game fans that are out there that are nervous. Sherlock Holmes adventure game for the PC is coming out where he fights Jack the Ripper.
Nice.
Number two, there's a vampire adventure game coming out from the people that were big time in the LucasArts animation team back in the Sam & Max days. That's going to be great. And then Tim Schafer... is doing his new game. Watch the Spike VGAs when they premiere to see the premiere of Brutal Legend starring Jack Black. Yes.
Yay.
In the game, he voices the main, like, it's like a Full Throttle style
sweet
metal character. His new adventure game, or I actually it's kind of like more of an action game, but just all three things for adventure fans. Great. Check those out.
Can I change my answer? I just realized.
Yeah, real quick.
Under a Killing Moon.
Oh my God! You knew right where to go. We need to do a whole episode about Tex Murphy.
That game, yeah. And the whole Tex Murphy thing. You need Under a Killing Moon to be remade so people can learn to love Tex Murphy.
Don't get me started. I'm going to start singing Richie Havens.
I know exactly.
We got to close the show out here. But right. That was, you know, a whole heap of nostalgia. So I think we'll skip that. But you are like us and you grew up geek and you would like to share some thoughts with us or memories, please do. Our email address, as I said, is mail@growing-up-geek.com. Thank you for listening. My name is Brad.
Nectar of the gods, sweet chocolate pie.
And we'll catch you next week.
Under a Killing Moon.
That is. Yeah.
You break it in so late that no one sees, or so you think. All you want to do is sweet fight. A pair of coin inserts are glowing red like demons' eyes. Do you got a pair to insert? Street fight. All you wanna do is street fight.